Hello and welcome back to the Roundup. Today we have a very special episode. There'll be no piss taken in this episode. This is going to be a serious discussion about Rangers and Celtic. I want to look at both Rangers and Celtic's past season, and I also want to look into the future of where they go from here. I know I don't normally discuss football, but this is a one-off. If you do, however, want to check out more content on Scottish football and you're, say for example, a Rangers fan, might I suggest you check out CG Novo. His channel's linked in the description. If you're a Celtic fan, I'm also going to recommend Keepers, whose channel again is linked in the description. As you probably already know, I'm a Rangers fan. However, I'm going to try my best to remain unbiased throughout this video, because I'm more passionate about Scotland international level. I also want to say that racist and sectarian comments will not be tolerated. Do not leave them down below. They're not wanted, they will be deleted. We're here to have an honest discussion about football. It's 2017. We didn't need it. Make sure to keep the debates friendly. It is only football at the end of the day. Alright, so without any further ado, let's get into it. The Glasgow Celtic. Prior to this season, Celtic had just won 5 in a row, looking to make it 6. I'm going to hand you over to Keepers now, who's going to tell you a bit more about Celtic last season and where they go in the future.
From a 1-0 loss to Lincoln Red Imps to an undefeated domestic treble, Celtic have come a long way over the last year when Brendan Rodgers took to the hot seat at Celtic Park. With Rangers back into the top flight, with Aberdeen and Hearts continuing to grow, this season was going to be a scorcher, and it lived up to be much, much more than that. A new influx of professional personnel joined Rodgers as he steered the tight ship toward an unspeakable achievement. New additions joined the green and white comrades in the battle for Scotland, impeccable players both individually and, more importantly, collectively as a team. Fans like myself came in numbers to watch the newly invigorated Celtic showcase their newfound ethos and playing style to truly get Celtic Park off their feet and rocking. The almighty thunder was only just brewing. Week in, week out, Celtic grew stronger in quality, the individual players grew stronger as a team, one unit, one band of people to play football the Glasgow Celtic way. Europe came around and Celtic gave it their best shot, coming up with some remarkable results against top-class oppositions, results which were in our favour and others not quite so much. Betfred Cup, done. Ladbrokes Premiership, done. And then it came. The chance to go undefeated domestically and win the Scottish Cup, done. With fans elated and probably still in ecstasy, we're all eagerly looking forward to next season. But what does that hold? How do we improve upon an undefeated domestic treble, an achievement that we would be lucky to ever see again? Recruitment this summer is a must. Celtic's main objective will be to widen the already almighty gap in Scottish football. And with the board 100% behind Brendan Rodgers, we need to expect to see some superb signings this summer. Continuing to stamp our mark on Scottish football, the treble is a must again next season. Whether that be undefeated is a completely different matter. A side quest will be in place to attempt to continue this undefeated run as long as possible, although not a main priority. There's bigger, more crucial tasks at hand. The European stage is where Celtic fans are craving improvement, and with correct recruitment, preparation and dedication, there's no reason why Celtic cannot go further than we've ever gotten before. Whether that be to equal our furthest stage of the first knockout round to the Champions League, or have a crack at the Europa League via becoming third placed in the Champions League group stage. But for me, the most crucial objectives would be to continue Scottish football dominance, flawless recruitment with both staff and players, and to show Europe and the world that Glasgow Celtic aren't in Europe to make up numbers anymore. But for now, I'm going to relish in awe of one of the greatest achievements ever seen in Celtic history. Until next season anyway.
So there we have it. Celtic, even by my admission, had a good season, despite my best efforts to try and wind up Marley. They managed to achieve an invincible season and secure the domestic Scottish treble. Brendan Rodgers has now set his eyes on the round of 16 in the Champions League. Personally, I think that unless Celtic makes some drastic signings, that'll be really, really tough. Celtic's motto is to buy players cheap and sell for profit. And if they stick by that motto, they're probably going to continue to struggle in the Champions League. Patrick Roberts this season's returning back to Manchester City, and it looks like Moussa Dembele could be on the out. With that being the case, Celtic might struggle to find strong replacement players for them that'll help support their Champions League campaign. Brendan Rodgers does have some good connections with his past management experience at Swansea and Liverpool, so it could be possible. But in reality, not many Champions League quality players are likely to want to come up and play in Scotland, especially if they're able to get first team football with the English Premier League clubs. Maybe Rodgers could convince them like Souness did with Rangers? Maybe not, we'll have to wait and see. You know I've been taking some time and now. The Glasgow Rangers started this campaign off having just been promoted for the Championship after winning the title. I'm going to hand you over now to CG Novo, who's going to tell you a bit more about Rangers' season.
Hello everyone, this is CG Novo, 982. and this isn't my channel. Today I'm going to do a quick little roundup for Batch on his YouTube channel, on my sort of point of view on how the Rangers season went. Obviously, it didn't go quite as some people's expectations were, but I think some people were a little bit confused and they didn't really understand that we're not the Rangers of old, and I mean that because we don't have all the money behind us. We haven't had a lot of years in the ESPL to get used to the football, to bring good enough players in. It took us two attempts to get out of the Championship. So that should have sort of dulled everyone's expectations, but because how well we played in the Championship, how many games we won, what we did to Celtic in the semi-final, I think it sort of screwed people up and raised expectations to an unbelievably high, impossible angle, which was never going to be able to be done. We would never have been able to sort of reach that. Second place would have been nice. That's what I predicted, but to be honest with you, I sort of underestimated with the likes of Aberdeen, who's kind of flew away. You saw what they've done in the last game of the season, for Christ's sake. They're obviously a very good side, and they've got a lot of years to sort of build up when Rangers have been sort of building up with sort of lower quality-esque players. So I think it's just a matter of where your mind was, where it goes. To be honest with you, I don't think it was all too bad. You look at it, we did finish third, we did qualify for Europe. We've sort of got a manager now who believes in the youth system, who's got a bit more of a direct style of playing rather than War Britain's sort of pass back, putting us under pressure bullshit. He's got his faults, Pedro. I'm not going to say he's absolutely perfect, but what he's willing to do is he's already took a heavy stamp into the youth team. He's changed the entire setup. He's not afraid to play any of the young boys, Bierman, Bates, and the young boy Barjonas, who looks like $1 million, certainly shows that off. Even Aidan Wilson in the last game of the season looks like he's got a bit of something. He's not afraid to sort of call out players when they get it wrong, or even call himself out when he's got it wrong. So I think, to be honest with you, and maybe it wasn't the season that a lot of people were wanting, especially being a Rangers fan. We obviously wanted to be challenging and stuff like that, but we're nowhere near Celtic. It's going to take a lot of years. But what we did do is we took a step forward. Third place next season, we'll aim for second place. The next season after that, we'll try and build forward. European football, more money in the club, better quality players in the upcoming near future. So yeah, that has been it. It's not all doom and gloom that everyone's wanting to laugh at and joke at and everything like that. We did make some positive steps, and that's what I'm going to try and focus on. So thank you for having me on the channel, Batchy. Back to you.
So as CJ said, Rangers maybe didn't live up to the expectations of some of the fans, but Rangers definitely made some positive steps. Looking forward to the future of Rangers though, what can we expect? Well, since we don't really have a transfer budget, it's probably going to be a struggle to bring in top talent to compete with Celtic. So it looks like we're going to have to try and adopt their motto of buying cheap and selling for profit, at least until the club's more financially stable. Hopefully Pedro can make the right decisions and try and get Rangers competing for second place again. With Rangers still in rebuild, it's possible that Celtic could run away with the league for the next couple of seasons, but hopefully, with Rangers building year on year, we can hopefully push and get ourselves back on top of the SPL, preferably before Celtic win 10. Comparing the golfing class between Rangers and Celtic, it's easy to see why Celtic done so well in the league, and Celtic beating Rangers 5-1 at Ibrox really hammers home that point. Key players for Rangers this season have been Wes Fodringham and Kenny Miller, the 37-year-old striker, which really pales in comparison to Celtic's strong squad. Dembele, Armstrong, Griffiths, Brown, Sinclair, the list goes on. And as much as this may sound like bitterness from a Rangers fan, I genuinely feel that Celtic have suffered because of the lack of competition in the SPFL. In order to improve as a team, you must face tougher competitions. Playing tougher games day in, day out in the SPL will help to improve Celtic as a squad moving forward into the Champions League. With Celtic running away with the SPL and not really having a competition, it could cause them to take their foot off the gas and become complacent. We saw it happen last season when Celtic drew one each with Rangers. Celtic had the better squad by a country mile, but they got complacent. I think the draw came as a bit of a shock to Celtic fans, but it definitely caused them to take Rangers games much more serious around the rest of the season. They then went on to beat us 2-1 and then 5-1 at Ibrox. Speaking to a Celtic fan about the draw, he says that the draw was one of the best things that could have happened to Celtic. When I say there should be a tougher competition in Scottish football, I don't just mean Celtic Rangers, I also mean other teams like Aberdeen as well. It would be a good thing for the SPFL and Scottish football as a whole. So it's fair to say that Scotland at an international level have failed to impress over the years. It's been over 20 years since we last qualified for a major international tournament. Of course, you could put that down to the quality of youth players we've had through compared to other countries. But what would help improve Scotland at an international level? Well, let's take a look at Germany's DFB, Germany's equivalent of the SFA. It's been responsible for producing players like Draxler, Schürrle, Sven Bender, Thomas Müller, Badstuber, Hummels, Ozil, Gundogan, Royce, an endless list of German talent. In comparison, Scotland's produced fantastic players like Stephen Fletcher and Stephen Naismith, and a whole long list of other unforgettable. So what could Scotland do to try and further develop youth players? Well, it's been said that you're best to focus on the best of the best players, instead of the current system, which is to try and coach as many as possible. Teams like Celtic, Rangers and Aberdeen doing well well on a European level and investing heavily into their youth teams would go a long way as well. In recent years though, there has been some major improvements, players like Ryan Gold, Andrew Robertson, Kieran Tierney all coming through the Scottish ranks. And with Tierney now getting regular first team games at Celtic, it's only going to help improve him as a player. Rangers now need to go and do their bit to help ensure that they're doing the best they can to help further develop the Scottish future talent. Make sure they give them regular game time and the best chance they can to develop, instead of constantly buying in older foreign players. So what does the future hold for Scottish football? Well, the outlook now is much better than it was a few years ago, although there's still a lot more we could be doing to try and compete with other countries. Something a bit different today. This was a bit of a one-off special to mark the end of the season. I'd like to give a massive shout out to Keepers and CG Nova, whose channels are both linked down in the description. I strongly recommend that you go down and check them out. They both make fantastic content based around their respective clubs. Anyway, thanks for watching. I hope you enjoyed. If you did, make sure to drop a like down below. If you're new, maybe check out some of my other content and consider subscribing. Thank you for watching, and I'll see you all.
Alright, fuck it, I'm going in.
In the next video.